Okay, so we're going to jump straight in. And I'm not going to do any of the ice-breaking stuff with you. We're not going to bond. I'm not going to recite the poem. We're not going to hum or hold hands. We're just going to get on with it and do the work because we have limited time. So I'm going to ask you one, maybe two questions. I'm going to ask you, so why are you here this morning? And I know it sounds like a daft question, especially if my sad sense of humor has already annoyed you. And you must be scheming, okay, so if this is the best that O's got, like, where does it go from here?
Can't get any worse.
It's a technique. I start there and then it gets better. Like, seriously, how's it? It's lucky to see you. No, we know each other. Otherwise, I would never draw attention to somebody arriving late. We know each other. I bumped into other folk here this morning that I know, and I won't draw attention to them either because people don't like attention being drawn to them. But if you just follow my eyes, there are other people in the room too who I know, and it's nice to see you too. Like, this is a foundational question if you want the session to add value for you. I mean, you're my hostage for an hour and a half starting about 4 minutes ago. Make it count. Like, bullet, three reasons in your head why you're in this room this morning. Imagine now that I did have something to say to you during the hour and a half. Imagine now that I didn't just waste your time for an hour and a half. Imagine I gave you information that can help you to crank up your business. Imagine that I gave you stuff that can really help you to transform the way you engage with your people and to radically crank up your workplace culture to a point that your people would be willing to fight for better results. And imagine that this afternoon you have a session scheduled with them and your job is to give them a call to action. Your job this afternoon is to round up all of your people, put them in a room, and tell them why they should care. In your head, quickly, highlight the three bullet points of that call to action. Like, what are you going to tell them as a compelling reason as to why they should really care? Have you got something to work with? I'm not new to this sort of forum. I've worked extensively in the UK with an outfit called the Academy of Chief Executives, ACE. They do exactly what you guys do in a very similar format. I've worked with about 50 of those groups. Groups where 10, 12 or so MDs and CEOs of mid and medium-sized organizations, sometimes large enterprise, meet for a day a month, share ideas about why it is that they're in business and how they can improve it. I ask those folk when we have a workshop and we can really engage with each other what that compelling call to action is. I'm going to tell you some of the reasons that they typically come up with at the start of a session. If you think that those are real reasons that they gave me and not made up, go every time I mention one. They say, for the benefit of all stakeholders, to improve customer service, to crank up results, to create better products, to improve safety if it's relevant, and so on and so forth. I come to tell you that nobody cares. Seriously, probably not even you. You see, we make up stuff to tell each other in our boardrooms, no pun intended. We make up stuff to tell each other in boardrooms because it's sort of how we've been coached to run the dialogue, and it sounds okay. So why are we in business? To engage with customers, to create quality, to get customers to come back, to add value, to, like, nobody cares. And maybe in the next hour and a half we can explore what it is that really compels people to call themselves to action to a level that they will not only support what you want them to do, but so that they will be willing to fight for the outcomes that you need. That's a different game, isn't it? That call to action that you had in your mind a little bit, a few minutes ago, the ones that I just gave you. There's the recruitment poster for the US Marines. You think your call to action, the one that you came up with a few minutes ago, or the call to actions that I just mentioned to you, are going to get people to sign up to do this? Probably not. Imagine if we could have a call to action, a little bit radical, die first, then quit. I'm not a big show of hands presenter, and I'm not a big engagement presenter. You're not going to turn to the people next to you and have to chat with them. You're not going to have to pump your fist in the air or do any silly things like that. But if you give me a little bit of guidance, it helps a little bit. This is a little bit overstated, yes? But by show of hands, would it benefit you if you could crank up the level to which your people are willing to fight for what you need? I think so too. So for the left brainers, you know all about left and right brain stuff. I'm not going to give you that lecture, although if you want, I can. It's more interesting than stuff we meant here to be speaking to this morning. You know, the left brainers are those people who are detail-focused, analytical, timely, and orderly. Where are you? Show of hands. You should have become a traffic cop or a school teacher. I don't know why you're in this room. You're just going to waste my time and get in the way of interesting dialogue. Where are the right brainers? Cool. These are those who like meandering a little bit. These are the folk who like getting distracted. They like people. They like to, they're not necessarily extroverts. But, you know, they like to explore. They'll try anything as long as it's legal at least once. So for the left brainers, let's start with some data and statistics just to amuse you for a while. Because if you throw a pie chart at these O's, it makes them happy. So let's talk about employee engagement. So you know all about the Gallup polls. You know that the Gallup polls are the ones published in the Harvard Business Review once a year, and the Gallup polls are the most authoritative, most accurate, most respected employee engagement polls in the world. It's been running for 70 years. They have assessed 20 million people. They have worked in 80 countries, and they have a really good grip on what it is that engages people in the workplace and the extent to which people are engaged. They say that employees come in three levels. Tell me if you agree. They, by definition, say that employees come as engaged ones. These are the people who are passionate about their job and who have a profound connection with the company that they represent. Can you tell them apart from the others? How? Tell me what you see. They move fast. They carry stuff. They make eye contact. They sit up straight in meetings. They answer the phone. They respond to their email. They help when asked. They offer help when not asked. You can tell them apart, can't you? You want to know the sad part? But that's a different lecture as well. We neglect them most of the time because we're too busy managing the other folk. But hold that thought. Then there are people who are not engaged. These O's are basically checked out. These guys sort of sleepwalk through the day. These guys go through the motions, and because of the law of averages, just like you sometimes win at roulette, they sometimes get it right. And sometimes not. And they just go through the motions day in and day out. And then there are people who are actively disengaged. These folk are undoing the work done by the folk who are engaged. And they are actively doing it. Do you understand that? They are destroying value. This thing is flashing far too slowly for it to be a health hazard. But let me talk about this quickly. These folk don't rock up at work wanting to break your stuff and lose your customers. But as a consequence of their low level of engagement, they break your stuff and lose your customers. Now, do you remember McGregor spoke about X theory leaders and Y theory leaders? Google him. McGregor said that X theory leaders are those folk who believe that people need to be governed and controlled. They intrinsically believe, leaders who are X theory leaders, intrinsically believe that they have to manage and control their people. Y theory leaders, on the other hand, intrinsically believe in the good of other people. They believe that people want to make meaningful difference, that they want to live meaningful lives, and that they want to contribute. They recognize that sometimes there's stuff that stands in their way of doing so, but they don't intrinsically believe that people have to be managed, controlled, and no one done subiki for daidlik. This was a little test to determine whether you're a left or a right brain, a left or an X or a Y theory leader. I have to stop quickly. I'm on a sabbatical. I've come out of sabbatical for you this morning. I haven't worked with a group in maybe 6 months now. For my sabbatical, I'm building a house. With Andre sitting over there, my building contractor. The coolest building contractor I have ever bumped into. If you want to build anything, call me so I can introduce you to Andre. In the 6 or 7 months that we've been building, I haven't had one major issue, which for building a place is really unique. So I'm on site every day interfering with his work. Measuring stuff, climbing on step ladders, and using a spirit level. He's not been mean about it once. But I haven't worked with the group once in 6 months, so I wasn't sure this morning that I was going to remember my lines. However, if I can take a year off to build a house, I imagine it suggests that before taking a year off to build a house, I spoke frequently so that I could afford to take a year off to build a house. So I'm going to try my best to remember my lines this morning and not stuff it up, okay? Because this is like coming out of a coma. That was a little test to determine whether you're X-theory or Y-theory leader, because if you're an X-theory leader, when I showed the slide about people who are actively disengaged, you thought, yeah, those bluxums, I know exactly who they are. Those are the O's who break my stuff and destroy value. Well, welcome to the world, you're an X-theory leader. Now, McGregor didn't say that you need to be an X or a Y-theory leader. He said you are one or the other intrinsically. Figure out which one and stop managing by default. Step out of your comfort zone from time to time and apply learnt behaviors that will help you under the right circumstances to sometimes be an X theory leader when you need to and sometimes be a Y theory leader when you need to. But most of us go, if you agree, live and manage in default mode. Stop doing that. It's not doing your business any good. If you're a bomb squad commander, you want to be an X theory leader while you're at work. If you're a helpline advisor, you want to be a Y theory leader while at work. And for most of us, we want to be somewhere in between as the situation demands. It's called situational leadership. Let's chug along here because we're already behind. These people are destroying value. So 20 million people later, they've given us statistics as to the percentages. Tell me the latest percentages quickly. What percentage of people are actively engaged? They are passionate about their jobs. They have a profound connection with the brand that they represent, and they fight for positive outcomes. What percentage? 10. 20. Somewhere between 10 and 20. 5 and 20. 5 and 20.
I've got 1.
1 and 20. Is that it? Cool. What percentage of people are actively disengaged? 50, 80. I have 50, 80. 40, 80. 10, 80. You don't have a clue, do you? Cool, let me show you. I don't know about you, but I have enough points to go to Australia. I used to have an office in London. I have a business partner in Australia. I've worked on every continent. I stayed because I think this is where I belong. I don't know why you stayed. I think that we can change things here and improve. I think we can build a nation. I think we can create a place for our children, but I'm not so sure some days anymore, but I'll spare you that speech. This is not a racist statement. It is a statement of truth, having worked in 25 countries with clients. These stats are first world, not South African, because every time I step off the plane, I don't work internationally as much as I used to do until about 8 years ago, but that's a whole different speech as well. I never used that line. I've never said so many times in a row, that's a different speech, that's a different speech. About 8 years ago, something happened in our life that caused me to stop working internationally so that I could be home. Now I work mostly here. But every time I still step off a plane, as I walk up to the customs desk, I say to myself, I wish we had stats like this. Yes or no? So however yours is in your business, it's worse than this probably. I mean, just ponder that for a moment. I mean, do you get what you are fessing up to here? It's broken, isn't it? And if we don't change that, your best efforts are not going to build the business that you want. So let's figure out why it is that so many people are actively disengaged and so few people are actively engaged. Tell me why. It's not their own business, I agree with you, but they're O's in their own business who don't manage it as they should. In fact, I'm in my own business. I employ really good up-end staff. I employ top-end folk. They cost me a lot of money. But now that I'm not in the game as much this year, it's hard for them because I'm not managing it like I should. Make sense? Sometimes we get tired and we bail out a little bit, don't we? Why else?
They're
not passionate about what they do. They're just doing it for the money. Maybe it's intrinsic. Maybe it's their nature. Maybe it's because of their nurture. There's a whole new conversation. Maybe they're just not up to it today or this month or this year, but they're just not passionate about it. Why else are people not being engaged in their workspace?
Not recognized.
They're not recognized. I get it. They're not led properly.
They don't understand the purpose of their job.
They don't understand the purpose of their job. Maybe they haven't figured out why they're here. You see, that was a deeper question than you realize yet. Maybe already you want to ask yourself the question again, so why am I here? But they don't get what it's really about. A lot of these and many other reasons. Do you agree?
Yeah.
All of the above and many other reasons. I have a little theory of my own, and it centers around this. He has more Gallup research. Gallup does not only do employee engagement research. In fact, that's the smallest part of their environment. They also do happiness research. They poll 1,000 people a day. I don't know if you know anything about psychometry, but 1,000 people a day, 365 days a year, for the last 70 years is a lot of people. What percentage of people are happy with their lives to the extent that they are happy with their lives? Give me the percentage. 20, 30. Again, you don't have a clue. Let me show you quickly. Do you see a correlation? One quarter of these folk, if this math doesn't work for you, like daydream or read your email for a while, but yes, some real insight for you. One quarter of these folk check out before they get to work. Because only 33% of people are actively engaged in the workplace, lower in our environment, we agree. What happens to the other folk who woke up this morning and said, I am willing to be in the game, but then they don't check in at work? Where do they go? Well, stuff stands in their way. They are ready to be better engaged, but something is holding them back. You get it? I have a little theory. It's called the life score theory. If you want to humor me, maybe this is a profound insight for you. And maybe not. But hey, next month there's another session, and then maybe that speaker will bring you something profound. But this is the best I got. Next 10 minutes, the best I got. I'm going to ask you to ask yourself some questions quickly, and the questions are private and the answers are private. You don't have to write them down. It's a little mental test. You're not going to turn to the person next to you and share your score with them. In fact, no one's ever going to know. So if you really don't like me because of my weird style, it's okay. Spite me, don't participate.
That's reverse psychology.
On a scale of 1 to 10, score yourself in these four domains. You really don't have to write it down, but you're welcome to. 1 really sucks, 10 is awesome, they should be making a movie of your life. 5 is getting by, 8 is good enough. Do you understand the scores? 1 sucks, 5, must I explain 2, 3, and 4? Are you sure? Once I had to explain 6 and 7. Once I did some work for Telkom. It's like a private joke, don't worry about it. Once I did some work for Telkom, and I had to explain for their senior management team, and I had to explain 6 and 7 to them. But I don't need to for you this morning, right? So how's it going with you in terms of your relationships? How are you getting along with people? How do you get along with the people you live with? How do you get along with the person who shares your room? Or if you're that lucky, the people who share your room? How do you get along with the people who share your house? How do you get along with your teenagers? How do you get along with your neighbors, especially the one who has that little dog that does the stuff on your lawn, even when you put the Coke bottles with the water out? Is anyone still doing that? How do you get along with other road users, other commuters? How do you get along with the traffic cops and the metro cops on the road? How do you get along with the taxi drivers? How do you get along with a lady at the KFC drive-thru when she gives you the wrong order? Hey, he has a heads up for you. Maybe getting your order right was not the most important thing in her life. Yeah, it should be if you own a KFC franchise. But maybe she's a single mother holding down 3 jobs, and maybe she hasn't received her alimony in a year. Maybe she's raising her sister's orphans. Like, maybe if we stop thinking that the whole world revolves around us, maybe we can build better relationships. It's complicated for an assertive A-type personality like mine, who learned his trade in the military. But hey, if you're a little bit more forgiving, if you drop your expectations just a little bit, stuff can change. Haven't you noticed? But that's a different conversation. I'm going to try to not say that again, because now it's become like a little phrase, and I want to break away from it. How's it going with you and the relationships with your employees, your customers, and your suppliers? Give yourself a score on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 sucks, 10 is awesome, 5 is getting by, 8 is good enough. Have you got a score? Quick check-in. Is anyone in this conversation? Yes. Cool. How's it going with you in terms of your... They call it work-life balance nowadays. It's not really work-life balance. If you want to be successful in business or in a career, work-life balance is one of the prices you pay. Yes or no?
Yes.
But you can get it right if you focus, if you do some of the right stuff. I'm not talking about work-life balance. I'm talking about overall wellness. I'm asking, how's it going with you in terms of stretching yourself between what the world wants from you and what you want to give to the people that you care most about? Jokes aside now, and seriously, I'm just trying to make the hour and a half go by. So I'm prodding some of the time. I'm trying to keep you awake. I'm not as nasty as I seem. I mean, it would be stupid of me to step in front of a room full of people, assuming I've done this before, and to try and antagonize you. I mean, that would be like daft, wouldn't it? So not my aim. I'm just trying to like keep you in the conversation. Who of you, so I'm going to dumb it down for you a bit. Who of you know people that, who of you know people? Who only know people that you like? People that you care about? People that you care about a lot? People you would donate a kidney to? People you would donate 2 kidneys to? Let's call them your kidney recipients. You just visualized the people most important in your life, didn't you? Chances are, unless you're in a mom-and-pop store business, they don't work with or for you. In a big enterprise, chances are those people are not in the workplace with you, the people that matter most. What I'm really asking is, how is it going with you and them and the pressure and challenges that life is putting on you? How's it going at night when you get home empty with nothing left to give? Who of you will admit, sometimes we avoid some of the real issues at home because we just don't have anything more to give. Because like we're running on empty a bit. Go, if you agree. Give yourself a score on a scale of 1 to 10 with how it's going with you and the people who matter most. 1 sucks, 10 is awesome, 5 is getting by, 8 is good enough. How's it going with you spiritually? I'm not asking whether you are gekerk or not. I'm not asking whether you go to church, mosque, temple, or synagogue. I'm not asking whether you're a believer. I'm not asking whether you pray or whether you of jy boeke vat van tyd tot tyd. I'm not asking whether you go to services on a Friday or a Saturday or a Sunday. Or maybe you belong to a faith or a denomination that doesn't pick a specific day. I'm asking whether you see other people or not. One of the basic tenets that all of the faiths teach, but which we just don't practice. I'm asking whether you get it that people sleep under bridges at night. When you snooze under your electric blanket or on top of your electric blanket, if you want to be specific about it. I wonder whether you make eye contact with the beggars at the stop streets. Or whether you avoid them because it's easier. I wonder whether you ever wonder why the lady at the drive-thru at the KFC looks like she's having a tough time. I wonder whether you ever stop for long enough and wonder why your people are really disengaged. You know the builders who are building my house? When I'm going on about them stepping on my wife's plants in the new garden. They live in shacks. Some of them that don't have doors, I know, because they took the doors off the property when they could. No, true story. Because they don't have doors on their shacks. And I expect them to build straight walls. There's a little bit of a disconnect between living in a shack and not having warm meals for your children and then working 8 hours trying to build walls straight enough to please the Mulungu. You get it, don't you? How's it going for you in terms of your connectedness to the universe? Knowing that you're a part of something bigger. Knowing that what you do matters. Living a life of meaning and purpose. Doing right by other people. Doing the right thing when no one is watching. Honoring your word. Give yourself a score, scale of 1 to 10. You suck at it. You are awesome at it. 5 for getting by, 8 for good enough. Now the most complicated one. Is anyone still in this conversation or am I pissing you off? The last one, how's it going with you intellectually? I'm not asking how smart you are. I'm asking whether you have figured stuff out or not. I wish I had time to tell you about that movie that's now a Broadway show, Kinky Boots. I know that you think that it comes from behind the curtains at the video store, and I'm wondering how you even know what's behind the curtain at the video store. Who saw the movie, Kinky Boots? It's now a Broadway show. Watch the movie. It's a superb learning experience watching the movie. I don't have time now to tell you about the plot and the storyline, but I wish I could. But it was stupid mentioning it if I'm not going to, so. In the movie, there's this guy battling with his own sexuality, trying to find which role he wants to live, trying to figure out which gender he prefers for himself, trying to figure out whether he should have the surgery, trying to find a place. And then he goes and works in the small town factory in this, out in the Platteland in the UK, if they have such a thing, in a shoe factory where these toughos are. And then this one really tougho wants to teach this other guy who's a bit different a lesson. And then one night at the pub where this toughho is the arm wrestling champion and his name is on the board for all the times he's won the arm wrestling championship, he dares this guy to a arm wrestle. But the other is quite frisk as well. He dares him to an arm wrestle. And they're going to they bet that the winner has to make the loser do something. And the toughho and his cronies have figured out what really nasty stuff they're going to make him do when the toughho wins. You get the plot, don't you? And they have the arm wrestle. And actually, the guy who's a bit different can stand the other O's pressure. And actually, he starts to get him over and flashes through his mind all of how they humiliated him, how they've tainted him, how they speak down to him. And he wants to, like, slam dunk the O. And then he looks on the wall. And he sees that this guy's entire reputation depends on being the arm wrestling champion in this small village. And he lets him win. And the other O knows it. But he's a really good sport, so he doesn't make it look like he made him win. It looks authentic. Our guy has to get the other guy to do something. His challenge? Change your mind about something or someone else. Now, there's a challenge, isn't there? You know that you believe stuff, right? And if I say you believe stuff, most people firstly naturally think about religion. And you are clear what you believe about your religion, or big confession coming up. If you are not a believer, as I am, so why that moment of truth? Like, why would I say that to a room that clearly contains believers? Because I want you to not listen to my story? No, because I need to be authentic. But hey, I spoke to 3,500 religious leaders at the religious leaders conference in America. And after that, a monk came to me and said to me, I can relate, brother. And then a Orthodox Jew came to me and asked me whether I was reading their scriptures. And then a Catholic bishop said to me in the lift that he really found what I said meaningful because they were willing to listen past the part that I just told you. But I need you to understand that what I'm sharing with you this morning is not scripture-based. It's life-based. But it can be scripture-based if you want it to. Moving right along. You know that you believe stuff, not only about your religion, but about other things too. Like whether it's okay to be like the guy in the movie. Yes? You believe stuff about how relationships should work, about how you should treat your kids and how they should treat you. You believe stuff about how you should treat your spouse and how she should treat you and what your roles are. You believe stuff about whether you should make eye contact with a beggar at the stop street or whether he's just an annoyance. You believe stuff about everybody, don't you? You believe stuff about yourself, stuff that you learned during your formative years, ages 2 to 9. When they told you not to touch because it was going to break, rather than telling you to touch so that you could learn. When they told you not to climb too high because you were going to fall, rather than telling you to climb to the very top because from there you can see further. They told you that kinders moet gesien word en nie gehoor word nie. That cowboys don't cry. And then we learned to never question. To never ask. When I did my national service, the Jehovah's Witnesses went to jail for 3 years instead of doing 2 years national service. Did you even know that? They didn't go to military detention barracks. They went to civilian prisons. They served 3 years because they said, not in my name. So from someone that was a commandant in the old army, I look back now. Yeah, I could go to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and they can attach me to a lie detector. All of the stuff I know now and believe didn't just come from nowhere. It was in me all along. I didn't manifest war crimes. I didn't do vile things. But looking back, I was a part of a system that was unjust. Looking back, I wonder why I didn't have the courage to say, not in my name. You know why? I didn't know. There's a good excuse, isn't it? You know why? Because I'd never figured out what I believe. I am now more clear on what I believe about people's personal choices, about races, creeds, genders, and religions. Most of the people I speak to, most of the time, go, when I ask them, would you agree with me that most people are not clear on what they really believe? Buddy, if I left you in a room for 10 minutes, you could figure it out. But right now, it is not as clear in your mind as are your religious beliefs. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yet what you believe dictates every outcome of your life. What you believe absolutely determines your relationships, your results, your legacy. And then every time we get a receipt from a restaurant, we have to remake the decision about whether we're going to claim it from tax or not. We're wasting time, Oz. Like, figure out what you believe. Figure out what you believe about everything. Then ask yourself whether your beliefs are serving you well or not. Then ask yourself whether your beliefs are hurting the people that you love. Because sometimes we have beliefs that hurt the people we love. You get it, right? You know what I've learned? We can change beliefs. I was 26 years old when I understood that concept subconsciously for the first time ever. I was a school dropout who was a child alcoholic who could drink a bottle of rum for every one of, could drink a bottle of rum a day for most of the days I spent in the army in the early days. Then I met my wife who had just graduated as a doctor. I met her when I was a corporal. That's not like a big deal rank. She had just graduated from WITS. These are different worlds. You get that, don't you? She a communist, me not. I went to visit her one night at the Helen Suzman Hospital where she was working her pediatric round. The guy in charge of the unit was an openly gay man. I just tapped into the vernacular that I had always heard from the tough O's that I used to hang out with, that no gay O would ever touch one of my children. I would rather let them die. And she said to me, like, what are you thinking? Like, how can you construct a sentence like that? Like, what goes through your mind when you demonstrate prejudice? Now that I look back, I know it was a turning point. I didn't realize it then, but it was the start of recognizing that I believe stuff which I choose to believe. Yes or no?
Yes. Yeah.
And I buy into it, and I feed it, and I never clarify it, and I never question it, and I never consider the consequence. Do you get it? When I speak about intellect, I'm not asking how smart you are. I'm asking how clear you are on your beliefs. I'm asking whether you have figured them out. I'm asking whether you are changing some of your beliefs and whether you are conscious of the power of your beliefs. Give yourself a score on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 sucks, 10 is awesome, 5 is getting by, 8 is good enough. Have you got 4 scores? Average them out. Use your calculator. Okay, don't. I don't want to know your score, but I was in a room full of people, 1,300 retail bank managers from one of the leading banks. They had digi-voting systems. This is their live response. Tell me whether this response is a lie, yes or no. Did I make this up, or is it true? I'm asking you whether a room full of people like you vote this to the life score test that I just gave you. Yes or no? Yeah. True? Yes. We have work to do, bro, don't we? So what was that other question? Why are you here? Like, why are you really here this morning? Like, why are you putting aside an hour and half of your time to be my hostage? What is it you need to figure out? There's good news too. Gallup also finds that people are essentially intrinsically hopeful of the future. If you ask them about their future, give me that word, please. Help me out. Optimism. If you ask them about their optimism, 53% of people are optimistic that 5 years from now their life is going to be better than it is now. Yes or no? Yes. The eternal optimists, aren't we? So how's that working for you? This is a massive insight, though. Can you see the percentages? They speak to the other percentages. Can you see that? It's the same ratio. Lots of your people who are not engaged in the workplace are hopeful that the future is going to be better, and they are willing to do something about it. There's your foundational cornerstone. Psst. The optimism of your people to build a better life is the foundational cornerstone upon which you can build a process to better engage your people. Get it? Yeah. Yes, some more good news. Those are some of the countries that Steve, that's my business partner, and I. If you think that's three people, then you're not doing this right, okay? Never mind. So Steve and I have companies in 50 countries running our programs. Yeah, but I'm a liar because I've only worked in 25. I've become smart. I don't have to go to a country to get a company to buy my stuff anymore. I now get Barclays Business Bank to bring their people from 26 countries to me so that I can train champions up, so that I can send them back to use our systems, that I don't have to go to the places. But when Prague is one of the cities that they have to bring people from, I can say to Barclays, no, don't worry, I'll go there, because my wife and I haven't been there. And when I have to go to Pune in India, or when they have to send delegates from there, I can say, no, hang on, I haven't taken my family there, so I'll go there. But now I can get to pick and choose. Does that make sense? So we ask business leaders, mid-level leaders, and non-leaders from the organizations who we work with. We ask them a simple question in a survey. We ask, if the culture in your workplace was to become as good as it realistically could, how much improvement would there be in people's performance and productivity? You understand the question?
Yeah.
That realistic is a really important word. We're not talking about radically remaking everything in your space. We're just saying, if we cranked up the culture a little bit and people were a little bit more engaged, what would that do to your bottom line results? So he has an interesting insight. We separate the data into three levels: senior managers, mid-level managers, and non-managers. Of all senior managers that we surveyed, what do you think they tell us the percentage result upswing would be if they could realistically improve the workplace culture? Tell me quickly. You're 100% right. That's what they said. You know why? Because you're a senior leader, because you big deal in your business, and because you think like they do. And you think that whatever your current results are, you can improve it by 20% if you just crank up the culture. Now we ask mid-level managers, how much do they think we can crank up the culture? A remarkable 60% of them say whatever they're achieving now, they can achieve half more if you could just improve the culture. You want a real insight? We ask all non-managers. One quarter of them say, whatever we're doing now, we can almost double if you would just trust me more. Let me do what you employed me to do. Be a better leader. Give me the tools to do my job with. Stay out of my face for a while, and some other things. So you could crank stuff up if it wasn't for a couple of obstacles. research shows, not ours, research shows that employees in the workplace say they could improve their results but for one of two things. Tell me those things. Two things that stand in their way.
Bad
managers. Leaders, yes. Leaders, and the empowerment is a function of culture. You are part right, workplace culture. Because you were part right. In fact, you should have gotten it because you were right. I'm sorry, I messed that up. Okay.
I'm crying. I'd love one. No more.
Amazon. A culture turned. Seriously, Amazon, a culture turned. I said to you earlier this morning, I said 11 Rand. Buddy, I wish I made 11 Rand a book. You don't make money off books. It's our third book. You don't make money off books. Like, seriously? So whether you buy books off Amazon or, like, it doesn't matter. But the book is on Amazon. However, business leaders are telling us that they are finding everything they need to know about changing the culture in their workplace in that little book. It's a 2.5-hour read. Check it out. I think there's a third reason that these results manifest in workplaces. I think there's a third reason, and this is the bigger reason. Well, firstly, about workplace engagement. They were in this meeting. They said, we need more of what management experts called workplace engagement. He says, I don't know the details, but it has something to do with the idiots working harder and us paying them less. That's not workplace engagement. Okay. Workplace engagement, in my thinking, is when people are willing to fight for the outcomes that you need them to achieve. That they'll do what needs doing to get the job done. There might be, check the two slides I put in for you this morning that demonstrates this. I do bank for the Capricorn, I do work for the Capricorn work in Namibia. I do work for the Capricorn group in Namibia. At least now you know I don't rehearse my lines. anyone know of the Capricorn group? They are a serious business. They own, one of their assets is Bank Windhoek. Anyone know of Bank Windhoek? Anyone know of Windhoek? anyone know of Namibia? Okay. Their CEO said this a while back, and I just fed off it because it was very, very clever. He said to him, employee engagement is about getting fewer of our people to say, no, we can't, because, and getting more of his people to say, yes, I can, if, and leaders then creating that opportunity. Clever, isn't it? I know this is a poor quality slide. Oh, relax, Brewer. I'm not going to give you a lecture on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, but I can if you want me to. You want me to? You see, my thesis is now a prescribed work at UJ. How cool is that? Okay, so how does a school dropout do that? Well, it's complicated. So the new government brought in this thing called recognition of prior learning. Do you know about it?
Yes.
It's a very cool system. It wasn't designed for folk like me who wasted their opportunities because I went to 9 schools, not because my parents moved, but because schools wanted me to move because I didn't like the system because I had one amazing teacher. We're meandering now and I should stay focused. I had one amazing teacher. She passed recently. Her name was Mrs. Hoopfrisch. Her husband was Pieter Hoopfrisch, the Afrikaans actor, who sadly committed suicide a long, long time ago. Mrs. Hoopfrisch was my teacher for 2 years, both years in Standard 8. The children asked me to write, and her children asked me to speak at her funeral, but I couldn't, so I wrote something for her. She was the only teacher who ever believed in me. And so that year, I got 80% for English, and I got 3% for maths. Because I hated the maths teacher. I wonder whether someone was not paying attention. Like, wasn't someone stopping for long enough to say, hey, something's wrong. He has a smart kid, but the system is not designed for him. So I did work for a group of professors at UJ when it was still UJ. They really smarted, so after the session, they wanted to know where I studied psychology. I said at EPOL, which is a really funny story, but we just don't have the time for it now. Long story short, in between the army and when I met my wife, I worked night shift at EPOL as a gate guard. It was the only job I could get. Oh, if the story doesn't make sense to you, I didn't leave there as a lieutenant colonel. I left there just having become a young captain. Then I met my wife, made it through the ranks, left after 6 years in the army, but then continued to do my camps. Does anyone know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
And did it for many, many years and was an active volunteer. And I continued to serve until after the elections because I support the process. And in that system, I went through the ranks. So for many, many years, I had two careers. Does it make sense? If you want to catch me out about my story, ask me the questions. I have answers for them, like Hillary. So one of the professors wants to know where I studied psychology. I said at EPOL, because it was working at EPOL, at the gate, night shift. I preferred night shift because then people couldn't see me. True story. We had a bag with three buttons in it, two black ones and a red one, big coat buttons. It was before electronic random testing the way they have now. If you drew the red button, I have to search the trunk of your car. And I can remember the stuff that you said to me when I had to search the trunk of your car. You know what I learned working at the gate? I learned that great men are not measured by how they treat other great men, but that great men are measured by how they treat small men.
Yeah.
When no one is watching. You see, my psychology degree comes from EPOL. So the professor says to me, so why don't you have a formal education? I say, because I can't, because of this and that. He said, we need to change that. So I became a recognition of prior learning student at UJ. They assessed me. They said, I know enough. I can do a master's degree. Their first master's degree recognition of prior learning student at UJ. They took my thesis, they made it a prescribed work. I became a guest lecturer on the program. The professor quit and came to work for me to run my programs. You see, wisdom doesn't come from learning. Wisdom comes from living, but you got to pay attention, buddy. You got to stop sometimes and ask questions about why things are working out the way they aren't or the way they are. And if your relationships aren't working, you're doing something wrong. It's not them. You are like fundamentally stuffing up if your relationships aren't working. Like, figure out what you are hurting so that you can change it. Anyway, let me tell you about Maslow's hierarchy of needs, because now that I have a master's degree in leadership cum laude, I know all about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I want to tell you that Maslow was right. Certain things need to be in place because other things need to. Certain things can only be in place when other things are in place first. Do you fundamentally get that?
Yeah.
The reason our economy isn't working is because most of our people live in shacks. The reason our nation isn't working is because people don't have self-respect. Not because they chose to, but because the system took it away. The reason your employees are not engaged is because you are creating an environment that causes them not to want to be engaged. Your people will not be able to be engaged until they raise their life score. Because life score sits over here, not over there. And your people cannot do their best work when their life score is broken, and neither can you. You know your life score? You didn't just hear about it today here for the first time. I just gave it a name. You think about it all the time, don't you? And it's standing between you and what you want to achieve. Now that's an assumption, but I come to you with humility in spite of my narcissistic streak, taking the mickey out of you. I come to you not wanting to be arrogant, because then you won't listen to what I have to say. I come to you just honest. I wanted to say vulnerable, but that's too much of a girly word. So there's a prejudice, isn't it? If you have some thinking to do, go, hmm. So why are you here? Well, maybe you're here to start questioning stuff. Maybe you're here to start thinking about stuff. You see, there was this clever dude, his name was Dante. He was one of the great mystic poets. And Dante said in 100 years ago, Dante said, I was in the middle of my life when I found myself on a path in a wooded forest, only to find that it was the wrong path. Sometimes I feel like it's the wrong forest. Have you been there? You know, I'm in that phase of my life where I'm starting to validate whether I did it right or not. Fortunately, I made a decision a long time ago that I would validate myself through my marriage and my role as a parent, that those things would measure me, that all of the other stuff is just noise. So I'm not as rich as some of you, and I have fewer degrees than some other folk. But you should meet my kids. Be crystal on what matters. Because sometime down the road, you're going to ask yourself some hard questions. And it is true that people later in their lives regret more the things they did not do than the things that they did. So I think that we think a lot about our life scores and we ponder. I think we sit in the traffic every morning and we ask questions about why our life is the way it is, and we think we're making decisions about changing it, but we're not really making decisions. We're just bitching about stuff about woulda and coulda and shoulda. But then the real world arrives and attacks us, and then we have to do what we do to make a living for 6, 8, 10, 12, or 14, or 15, or 18 hours a day. And then tonight we get to sit in the traffic again and we ask ourselves the same questions, but we never make the decisions. I'm suggesting you get out of the traffic a bit, and I'm suggesting that we make the hard decisions. I quoted a great philosopher to you a moment ago. Let me quote another great philosopher, one who said that if you do not change, you'll just stay the same. I'm confused. I don't really know who it was that said it, but I don't know if it was Gandhi. Going to the house that Gandhi lived in when I went to India for Barclays was one of the coolest places I've ever been. Standing in the room where he wrote some of his stuff. I don't know if it was him or someone else that said, be the change you want to see. Change starts here. Change starts where you are standing. Change starts with you being a better, decent human being. Corruption stops with you bribing the metro cops. The end. It's as simple as that. So if we want to break out of this a little bit, I think we figure that we have to figure out what it is that drives us, don't we? I wish this was a workshop, but he took the budget option. So I have to be quick on this. We can't workshop this, but what is it that drives you? When I do workshop this with folk, tell me quickly the top three or five things that come on the list about the motivational drives of human beings. Quickly.
Better life for my daughter.
Better life for my children. You see, it's too far down this presentation to ask this question because you're thinking, and I'm not saying you wouldn't have answered that yesterday. Maybe you would have. But we down this journey already. Who of you are asking yourself questions? You see, the journey is on its way. Oh, I don't think the journey began for you here this morning, buddy. The journey began a long time ago. This is maybe just a small step along that. But what do the people typically tell me, the things that motivate people?
Money.
It's always one of the top three on the list. Recognition, achievement, career progress, stuff, reward, recognition. Yeah. Yeah. Let's explore that a little bit. What was his name? And the band's name? And the other three O's? Like, frankly, who cares? Brian May, Roger Taylor, Chris Deacon. Os don't know that. They just know the man. I'm not going to hold him up to you as a role model because, frankly, he was not a role model, but he was an awesome singer. He was an awesome role model for what you can do if you pull yourself up from your bootstraps. I went to Mercury's Tavern on the island. Which island? I'm not showboating with you. I get around because of my job. I went to the tavern where apparently his father worked or something before they moved, wherever. I was a big fan. In 1981, Freddie says this in an interview. He says, I used to have a dream. I wanted money. Now I've got it. But it now seems it was much more important to get the damn stuff than to actually have it. Maybe the challenge has worn off. Once I get something, I'm not that keen on it anymore. Show of hands if this relates to your life. You know that stuff that you think drives you? It does not. It's all just snowflakes in a furnace. The stuff that you think are going to cause you to do better are probably not the things that really push your buttons. But we think that they do because we thought that they did, because people told us that they might. and then we achieve it, and then what? I'm not doing this because of the Olympics. The Olympics now is a great moment for you to ponder this, but I use this example always, not now because of the Olympics. How long does it take to win the 100 meters at the Olympics? 9 point something seconds. So a number of years ago, I was working with the South African athletics team before they went to Australia for the Commonwealth Games. I was in a little auditorium at the Pretoria Sports Science Center with them in a room just about this big. The incline was just much steeper. Llewelyn Herbert was sitting just over there. Llewelyn Herbert, then the world's greatest 400 meters athlete. I asked those O's, how long does it take to win the 100 meters at the Olympics? Llewelyn Herbert, Llewelyn Herbert says, it takes 20 years, give or take. If you take nothing else that I have to say here this morning home with you, take that home with you. Your grandmother was right. It's about the journey, not the destination. It's in the struggle. Maybe the way your life was yesterday is how it was meant to be. If you would just stop resisting it. Maybe the challenges you face right now, maybe that's how it's meant to be, if you just stop the struggle. Maybe I needed to work at the gated EPOL so that I could visit with you this morning. But there I worked night shift so that people wouldn't see me. Because before that I was a decorated officer in a very fancy outfit. And that was like, I worked at EPOL. I left EPOL to find a better job. I went and drove cash for Fidelity Guards. Now that's a job that really sucks. Because the tellers dealt with me as if I was nothing. I didn't really learn about psychology at EPOL. I learned about psychology from the bank tellers while I drove cash for Fidelity. Maybe I had to work at Fidelity for a while before I could, maybe I had to drive the truck before I could drive what I drive now. If only I stopped resisting earlier on. Make sense? It takes 20 years to win the gold at the Olympics. I don't want to do anecdotal stuff now about our 400 meter athlete. How cool is he? Or wishing Castor well for this later this afternoon. We don't have the time. Like Mark Phelps, what's his first name? Michael Phelps. Can you even fathom? I read a tweet from a mate of mine in Australia, a guy who does what I do. He just probably does it better. He said, I'm so inspired by the Olympic athletes. And then I really realize how lazy I am. I think life is a journey. And I think the stuff that is happening maybe was sent. Oh, you don't have to be a believer to be deeply spiritual. Maybe there's a bigger link between these different levels of belief than we understand. But hey, that's a different conversation. I think that stuff happens the way they should. And if we can embrace them and figure them out, I think then stuff comes together. What was the point of that? In trying to improve one's life score, I think one needs to get that life is a series of stepping stones and that you can turn your stumbling blocks into stepping stones. There's a line I haven't used for many years. I wrote it a long, long time ago for a speech in America. It's a cute little line that we can turn our stumbling blocks into stepping stones, but we have to be paying attention. I have to pay attention to the time now because we are way behind. University of Amsterdam has been doing research on happiness for the last 20 years. They're trying to figure out what makes people happy. They have no clue, but they have figured out what makes people unhappy. They say the cancer of unhappiness is envy. Wanting what isn't yours. You know why? Because it reduces everything you have to naught. If you're standing at the rugby field wishing that your lighty was scoring more tries like the other O's lighty, you are reducing everything that your lighty does well to naught. This is not a punchline, it's not a joke, don't crack a smile. This is like serious. If you wish your lighty would pick rugby instead of ballet, you are reducing what he might be potentially good at if only you would get some of your own noise and prejudice and beliefs out of the way. Money doesn't motivate. Oh, we think it does, that's why we chase it. I'm a capitalist, don't get that wrong. Andre, I wish I could buy the better tiles, buddy, but I'm like twice over budget already, so I can't buy the better tiles. But I wish I had the better tiles because I like nice stuff. I did buy the better windows, though. Ask him. I like stuff just like you. But I know that money doesn't motivate. Because after a car ran my wife down 8 years ago, she was crossing the road. Because she was a very prominent doctor, the road accident fund paid her a lot of money. It doesn't change anything. Oh, she's well. You can stop worrying about her. She's never worked another day as a doctor, but she gardens now. And she takes care of the finances in the business. And she plays with our grandson. The reason for us renovating the new house so that we can move 8 minutes closer out of the house where we've been happy for 30 years, we're now moving 8 minutes closer. Like, Maureen is doing as well as she should. But I know that money alone is not a motivator. University, I don't want to misquote, I can't remember which university, they did research on money. They researched people who won the lotto and people who became victims of, who became disabled. My wife is not disabled. They became disabled as a result of an accident during their adult life and lotto winners. They found in the first 3 years after the accident or after the lotto, people changed a lot. But after about 3 years, they get back into their groove. And they found that after that, the people who were now disabled victims were no more unhappy than the people who won the lotto. Go figure. Money is a thing. It buys where you can be unhappy. But it's a thing. Let's move faster because we are out of time. There's another chapter coming. We're spending an hour and a half together. We're finishing at 9:45, not at 9:30. We're finishing at 9:45. We'll finish on time, but there's another chapter. Viktor Frankl, the father of existential psychology, the concentration camp survivor who wrote that awesome book, Man's Search for Meaning. Viktor Frankl said the primary motivational drive of man is to strive for and find meaning for his life. Yes or no? Ladies, this is not a sexist statement. That's how we wrote in 1945, 1946 when he wrote this. I don't want to change the vernacular because I don't want to mess with what he said. He meant humankind. Go hmm if you agree. Mm-hmm. You check. We are chasing the wrong things and we are mistaken about what it is that will improve our life scores. The pursuit of purpose and meaning will engage people in the workplace. The realization that their work is important, assistance to live a life that is valuable, a reminder that what they do counts, recognition of the fact that when people do their best work, it makes something better. Viktor Frankl said something else as well. He said that you can unleash the potential of another human being through the mere act of believing in them. Yes? I'm it. Her name is Maureen. After Mrs. Hopefully, she was the second person in my life to believe in me. Because when I was an army corporal and everyone else told her she was making a mistake, she said she would stick with it. When her father stopped speaking to her, because she was the first graduate in their entire family and they had hedged all their bets on her and then she picked me. It was a bold decision. When we got married with a lucky packet ring, true story, and nobody came, my family didn't come because it was a across the line religious wedding. So my family didn't come either. Well, my parents did, but nobody else did. So when we married out of our faiths and people decided that that wasn't good enough, she said it was okay, it was going to work out. You know, to this very day, she has never told me that she believes in me. But that who she is speaks louder than what she says, just like you. And I knew from that night in that ward at the Ellen Joseph Hospital, I knew. You see, when you believe in someone so much that you are not guided by evidence of their behavior or performance, but through the desire for them to be better, something changes. Do you get that? Yes. You want to engage your people? Believe in them so much that they cannot fail. And then they will fail. And then you help them figure it out, and then something changes. No, it's not an easy tactic. It's not a technique. It's a philosophy. But it works. Because he said so, not because I say so. Shortest version I can. You know that it's more fun flying Kalula than other airlines. You know why I could do 15 minutes stand up on this. It's quite funny, but we don't have the time right now. You know why they tell you to attach your own mask first before you attach the mask of your children or the mask of the other passenger? It's obvious, because if you're not breathing, you can't help others to breathe. If you want to engage your people, you need to raise your own life score. Because Maslow's hierarchy said that self-actualization is the highest level, the demonstration of excellence in your everyday living. But then his daughter published some of his work posthumously. And therein, it was evident that he knew during his lifetime that the highest level of existence was not self-actualization, but was self-transcendence. Helping other people to demonstrate excellence in their lives. As a fact, people change for one of only four reasons: because of a near-death experience, because of a life-changing event, because of a religious experience. Religion, not necessary. Oh, please don't go at me. I shouldn't be doing this. We're wasting time. Don't think this is a religious stab. It's not. My children are observantly religious. We're a Jewish family. Go figure. You go figure that one out. My children are what you call shomrei. My daughter doesn't drive on the Sabbath. She doesn't turn a light on the Sabbath. My children are deep religious. Well, she came out of my home, so maybe she learned what she knows from somewhere. Maybe I created an environment that would support that. Not anti-religion. I'm anti-bigots. I'm anti-racists. I'm anti-assholes. But I'm not anti-religion. Where were we? Number four. Religious experience, by definition, Google it, means a moment of awakening, a moment of awareness. Got it? Not necessarily a faith or teaching. It means watch the sun rise one morning and be amazed. And it's a religious experience. The fourth reason is because of the influence of another human being. I think that people don't change because of one of those. No, I'm sorry. I'm messing this all up. Because of personal choice. A near-death experience, a life-changing event, a religious experience, or personal choice. I don't think people change because of that. I think people change because of one reason and one reason only. Because of personal choice. People change when they are good and ready to change. I think there are four things that can cause them to choose to change. A near-death experience, a religious experience, a moment of awakening, or the influence of another human being. You. When you behave in a way that inspires other people to choose to behave more like you, you've become immortal. You have. Because they're going to pass it on, and it's going to be a legacy. And seven generations from now, people will be behaving in a way that they don't know why they do, but because someone saw you do it. Did you get it?
Yeah.
That's leadership. That's life leadership, and that's how you get your people engaged and on board. Attach your own mask first. So why are you really, really here? I don't know. You go figure it out. Maybe you're really, really here to ask yourself some hard questions so that you can improve your own life score even better than your previous journey has enabled you. So that maybe you can engage your people better. So that maybe you can play a meaningful role in their lives. So that maybe you can change the culture in your workplace to a point that really supports your drives and desires and ambitions. So that maybe you can make more money. You think, I think it's okay if the outcome is to be more affluent, more successful. It's okay, but do it the right way and through the right mechanisms for the right reasons. In our remaining time, we're going to talk about workplace culture. So every business leader knows. I hope you're not confused by what we just did. Every business leader knows that culture is important. Yes? Driven by how you behave, by the way. But most business leaders recognize that they don't know how to manage workplace culture in simple and practical terms because they think it's complex. It's not complex. Steve, my business partner, figured out how to dumb it down, and then he and I over the past 15 years have managed to dumb it down completely. He has the crash course on that. This was meant to be a crash course. I spend more time on the other stuff. I'm about 5 minutes behind. I'm not going to run 5 minutes over. I'm going to cram this a little bit for you, but I intended to cram the session for you, so it's okay, chill, relax, it's all going to be okay. There's something called unwritten ground rules, UGRs. UGRs are people's definition of this is the way we do things around here. UGRs are people's definition, people's perception of this is the way we do things around here. So I learned about UGRs when they took me away from my mother, put me on a train when I was 18, 19 years old, sent me to Oudtshoorn. As I stepped off the train, I learned there that to survive there, I should never question authority. I don't care whether you were there or not. You know the story. I'm asking you, how long did it take me to know I should not question authority? Minutes. You know why? Because there was a UGR that said, don't be a dumbass, don't question authority. It was an unwritten rule. You get it, don't you? There was a UGR that said, you never volunteer. There was a UGR that said, you never show weakness. There was a UGR that says, you never confess to making mistakes. Those UGRs dictated how people behave. No one ever taught you the UGRs. You figured them out for yourself as you stepped off the train and then you subscribed. Get it? So you know that UGRs exist, don't you? Now, UGRs don't even only exist there. They exist everywhere else. They exist where you work. They exist in your company. They exist in your enterprise. In your workplace, they are UGRs. Not necessarily like the ones I'm going to describe now. These are just ones that I saw in other companies, but they are UGRs in your workspace. Here are some that are typically found in typical companies. People say, at our meeting, it isn't worth complaining because nothing is going to get done. And then people stop giving suggestions. And then nobody ever speaks up and then nothing ever changes. There are UGRs that say, how many meetings do you need to attend before you know that this is true? I can stop now. You get UGRs, don't you? People see whether there is an integration between the front office and the back office, and then they know whether they should support one another. A new employee will know on the first shift whether or not the boss takes an interest in them, or whether the only time they get spoken to by the boss is when they do something wrong. Somebody knows this on their first day, true or false?
Yes.
Once they know this, will they ask for help?
No.
Will they ever confess to making a mistake?
No.
Will they ever reach out and give an opinion?
No.
There are UGRs that say we go through the motions with our bosses, but once they're gone, we do what we want. There are UGRs that says management talks about the importance of service or the importance of people, but we don't really mean it. Because I was in my manager's office when I heard him speak to that client on the phone in his smiley voice, and then I heard what he said about the client after he put down the phone. I know whether we should respect targets and deadlines because I can see whether our meetings start and end on time or not. I know what's important to my boss, not through what he says or she says, but through the questions that they ask me. That really is an advanced module. But if you want to change the people perceive you, go and figure out the questions you typically ask them, because you typically ask them questions. And you ask the same questions, phrased the same or phrased differently. But you have a repertoire of questions. They know the questions, they know the answers, and they know what you value because of the questions. If you want to shift the focus, change your questions. And the reason that all of this works is because nobody wants to fit out. Everyone wants to fit in. So people subscribe to the UGRs. So here's how it works. New guy arrives at work. He says, can you repeat that part about the stuff where you said all about the things? Because basically he doesn't have a clue. Then we send him on induction program. What happens on induction? Well, we teach him the policies, rules, and procedures, don't we? Oh, if you run a smaller enterprise, you might not have an induction, but you have an induction. You show them where the fax machine is. If you still have a fax machine, maybe you should step into the new millennium. But you show them where the fax machine is, don't you? You show them where the loo is, you tell them how to use the kitchen, and through certain dialogue, you tell them what's important and not important. After a while, they know what the rules are, yes or no? And then they work one day in the office and then they know whether they have to adhere to those rules or whether they can toss them aside. Not because of what the induction taught them, but because of how they see other people and you behave. We have a rule in my business. I dare you to call my bluff. I wish you will call my bluff. Go to my office, ask them to see their employment contracts. They'll show you. It says they are not allowed to lie. If somebody lies to me about why they're late, I will terminate their service. No, I work in a really empowered environment. Finish listening before you judge me. They know that if they make the worst, when Sharon recently paid 6 digits worth of money into the wrong bank account, when she hyperventilated, when she couldn't speak because she was crying and she phoned me, I was the first person she phoned. How cool is that? And then I said, it's okay, don't worry about it, we'll fix it. I said, how much money? I said, thank God it won't bankrupt us, it's really gonna hurt us. This year, you're not going to get 4 times monthly salary extra as a bonus. This year, you're going to get a smaller bonus maybe. But Sharon is going to phone her, ask her. You know why? Because we stuff things up in life, don't we? Then we fix them. But if they 8 minutes late and they tell me it was because of the traffic and there wasn't traffic, they are not allowed to work for me. And if they want to take me to the CCMA, I will shut my business. You know why I'm so fanatical about it? Because truth is important. You know how they know it's important? Because I never asked them to lie on my behalf. You know how they know it's important? Because they never hear me say to a client or write in an email, I never got the mail, or the check is in the mail, or our network was down. I write an email and say, hey, dude, I really stuffed up. Admin doesn't work. One of my people phoned him 2 days ago and said, your relationship with us until now has been disastrous. She said that to you. I instructed her to. She said, the mistake was that Steph handled the admin, and he sucks at it. She said, as one of his key account managers, if he had given it to me, it would have worked. She said that to you. That's how business should operate, shouldn't it? We are crystal on the things that are important, and they see it through your behavior, not through what you say. So a new employee goes to the first day on the job. Yeah, the signs they see. Actually, it starts before this. It's the first time they go for an interview that this dialogue starts. But here's what goes through their minds. If they don't have an email address on day one or a desk, or the other people are not expecting them, or other people are not excited to see them, it gives them insights about UGRs. When their first meeting starts late, it tells them whether they should honor targets and deadlines. When they see in a safety environment the boss not wearing his hard hat, it tells them it's okay for them not to wear theirs. When they see the guy saying to somebody on the phone, yeah, I'm already on my way, the traffic's just a little bit jammed up. You get it, don't you? New employees know on day one how they should behave. You need to change the day one experience. And you need to change every other day's experience of how you behave so that they can see the truth that was not intended, so that they can see manifest what you expect of them, that they can know what is important and that they will value what is important because you show it in your behavior. So I'm going to make a big call here. I'm going to say that workplace culture eats strategy for breakfast. I don't need your permission. Business schools everywhere agree with me. CEOs of some of the biggest companies in the country agree with me because the stuff we do works, because I've worked with 80% of the top 100 companies in South Africa, because their CEOs tell me they agree. Their strategy counts for naught when their culture does not support its implementation. And we've got to change that. If you don't understand UGRs yet, yes, UGRs in a nutshell. So scientists take 5 monkeys and put them in a cage. You know the story, don't you? It's a cage with a very high ceiling, and in the center of the ceiling, there is a trapdoor. Through the trapdoor, they hang a bunch of bananas. Underneath the trapdoor, there is a stepladder. Scientists have got a glass window through which they look in. It's a one-way mirror. The monkeys can't see out, but the scientists can see in. There is an ice-cold, high-pressure water spraying system on the roof that will drench the monkeys in ice-cold water at the push of a button. Scientists put the 5 monkeys in a cage, miss a meal, then hang a bunch of bananas. What do the monkeys do? Go for the bananas. What do the scientists do? Push the button. What do the monkeys learn? Don't go for the bananas. Now the scientists take one of the original 5 monkeys out. No, first they disconnect the button. They don't need the button anymore. Now they take one of the original 5 monkeys out, put a new monkey in. What does a new monkey do? He gets bluxomed while going for the bananas. Scientists take one of the other 4 original monkeys out, puts a new monkey in. What does a new monkey do? Who claps him the hardest? The one who came in yesterday. So they continue. Finally, they take the last of the original 5 monkeys out, puts a new monkey in. Before he comes in, the other O's left and right him quickly and explain to him that he better not even think about bananas. Now he sits in the corner looking the other way. Why? Nobody knows. Around here, that's just the way we do things. It's called culture. It's driven by UGRs, unwritten ground rules, people's perception of this is the way we do things around here. We've built a system around this. We've built we have some of the coolest. Kmart in Australia, their MD, Google him, look him up on LinkedIn, write him. He says that one of the 3 things that caused his company to go from the 6th best retailer in Australia to the best retailer in Australia over 6 years was his UGRs program, our system. He did other things too, McLaren doesn't employ us in the UK because our system doesn't work. McLaren employs us because we're smarter than some of their engineers, because our stuff works. Because when we do a when we do a survey for Kmart across 30,000, 35,000 people on mobiles, it works and it doesn't fall over. And we can measure culture and we can assess the UGRs and we can do a quantitative and a qualitative survey and we can show them the statistics. Then we can analyze it. Then we can look for recommendations for improvement and so on and so forth. We might be able to figure out ways for you to do some of this because our stuff is geared at large enterprise. But for a long time, I've been toying with the notion of creating a modular system for this, for small and medium business to use it. And maybe we put our minds to it and maybe we don't. That's why you, never mind. I can't remember where I was. UGRs is a five-step system. I'm going to tell you the five steps because you can go away and go and do them. We are back on time now. Everything's going to work out. UGRs is a simple five-step process. You know what? I'm going to send you some stuff. I wasn't going to, but I'm going to. I'm going to send you stuff to send them. So you can stop writing. I'm going to send you stuff. Okay. It's a five-step process. You can do all of this for yourself. You don't need us. We just figured out how to do it perfectly. We can make it easier, but you can do this for yourself. Read the book. It tells you exactly. The book is a corporate novel that takes what we've seen in all the companies we've worked with, makes it into a story of a business and how they turn it around. It tells you the five steps. In step number one, you want to envision the type of future that you want. I promise you I'm going to send you the stuff in our 4 minutes left. Listen to this rather than jotting it down. But jot if you want to, but you're going to lose some of the nuances. Most businesses have value statements that are on plaques and posters and on the internet. Nobody cares. Please trust me. Nobody, please believe me. Nobody gives a shite. If you add an E, I learned in Ireland working there with a company that it's not a swear word. Nobody gives a shite. Nobody knows what the value, they don't care. Review your values, engaging your people, and getting them to be a part of envisioning the type of culture that they want to work in. Does that make sense? It can just be a dialogue. It can just be a conversation. Or it can be an assessment. Step number two, assess the current UGRs that are driving those outcomes. We do something called the UGR stock take. It's a very clever survey. I'm going to tell you how to do it quickly. Use lead in, not leading. lead in sentences. You want to know about accountability? Ask people to finish a sentence like this anonymously on a piece of paper, on an index card. Use SurveyMonkey, okay? So we are way beyond SurveyMonkey, but use SurveyMonkey. Ask people to finish a sentence like this. If you are wanting, over here they say we want an environment where people are accountable. Got it? Now assess the current UGRs as it relates to that. Let me give you an example. Accountability. Ask this question around here when it comes to meeting targets and deadlines, dot, dot, dot. The answer to that question is going to tell you exactly what people think about accountability. Around here when someone needs help, dot, dot, dot. Around here when you make a mistake, dot, dot, dot. Around here when the pressure is on, dot, dot, dot. Do you get it? If you want to talk about teamwork. Around here when somebody is taking strain, dot, dot, dot. Around here when someone needs help, dot, dot, dot. Around here when someone is under pressure, dot, dot, dot. Around here when someone is dealing with a challenge, dot, dot, dot. Do you get it? You then relate those answers to whether they're going to have a positive or negative impact on your business results. Now you have a quantitative response. You can make a pie chart. You read the comments. Now you have a qualitative insight. Get to understand it and do something about what the people are telling you. Step number three, teach people about UGRs. Tell them the monkey story. The end. Step number four, involve people in crafting the positive aspirational UGRs that they want to see in place. How do they want it to be? That around here we truly care about one another. That around here we do what we say we are going to do. That around here we tell the whole truth faster. That around here we rely on one another. It's not just values in different words. It is something that people can subscribe to and they are willing to fight for. First, because they understand it will influence their life score. Here's a quick insight for you. The things that will primarily influence your life score are your relationship with God or the universe. Yes or no?
Yes.
Your relationship with your kidney recipients. Yes or no?
Yes.
Your relationship with the people at work. Yes or no?
Yes.
Of those three, Your relationship with the people at work has a disproportionate impact on how your life score is going. Yes or no?
Yes.
When your employees understand that, they will understand that they are in a room full of like-minded people who, if they were willing to fight to improve their life scores, would improve your business as an unintended consequence too.
Yes.
Involve them in crafting the positive aspirational UGRs that they want to see in place, and then embed those through 360 assessments, through the way you behave, through reward and recognition, and through absolute demonstration of those behaviors in your own behavior. I'm not going to look at my watch again. I'm probably 1 minute in hand, and I'm probably going to run 2 minutes over. Get over it. Here we go. We just took a small bite. It's a metaphor. Must I explain it? So we just took a small bite of the apple here today, but here's the real nutshell of UGRs. Who will not park here? Show of hands. We need to do this really quickly. Who will not park here? Like, I mean, absolutely not. You know that Maureen doesn't park there? She struggles to walk long distances. She won't park there. So what was he thinking? Oh, maybe you would park there if they're giving away Jimmy Choo's. buy one pair, get three pairs. That one daughter who's the mother of the grandchild got married in a Vera Wang. Go figure. She would swim the Indian Ocean to get her Vera Wang dress. She would probably park there if she had to get to the store in time if it was before closing down. There are some people who will park there. What was he thinking? No, he was thinking. Psst. He has the crux of the culture conversation. Listen to me. No, listen to me. Nobody breaks a rule without justifying it in the back of their minds. That's what drives culture. He was thinking, I don't care, or I drive a Beamer, or I'm more important than the others, or I'm going to... But he was justifying it. Got it? You know why he did that? He lost a bet. On board, as you step onto the plane, her job is to make you feel welcome, so she should greet you. And if you're a frequent flyer, she sees it on your boarding pass, and she should greet you by name. One day she does not greet me by name. I know she's not doing her job. Because I'm a frequent flyer, she knows she's not doing her job. But hey, it's just a customer service thing. It's not about safety. It's not important. So she doesn't greet me by name. I wonder why. What she doesn't know is I know she's justifying it. Maybe she's justifying it because she had to clean up a kid's puke in the previous flight. Maybe she hates business class passengers. Maybe she doesn't like this route. Maybe she didn't get her alimony check. But she's justifying not doing her job. Yes? Then I sit in my seat. Guys, we are seconds away from finishing. Then I sit in my seat. I look out the window. I see him. It's midsummer, not winter. He's wearing long sleeves, not because it's cold, but because it's a safety thing. He's wearing a peak cap because it's a safety thing so he can make eye contact with the captain into the sunlight. He's wearing gloves because it's a safety thing. He's wearing hard cap boots because it's a safety thing. Maybe she didn't greet me because her bunions were sore and she justified, I'm going to not greet him because I don't care enough. When his bunions are sore, does he wear the safety boots, yes or no?
Yes.
It's a safety rule and you don't get to break it. I'm just wondering, why don't we get people to live by the rules that we agree to? Take drugs into Singapore, you will die by military firing squad. There are no drug rehab centers in Singapore because there are no drugs, because there are no drug addicts. You see, it's crystal. I'm not suggesting that you run a business like that. I'm just asking, why can't we run a place where we say that we respect each other and then do it? Why can we not run a business where we say that integrity counts and then hold one another accountable? Why can we not run a business where we let people make mistakes and then allow them to do it? And why can't we run a business that becomes a responsible citizen and does things the right way? Because we can, if we are just serious enough about it. I am 4 minutes over. My apologies. I'm going to see you after the break. Thanks for coming this morning. It was lekker spending time with you.